Hello, everyone. Welcome to my session. It's my great honor to make this talk. My name is Xu Peng. I'm a PhD candidate from Chinese Academy of Sciences. My main research area is software and system security, focusing on effectively finding bugs in critical software. Today, I'm going to introduce our research work. It's about how to find a large number of vulnerabilities in the binding code of scripting languages with cooperative mutation. It's a joint work with Yanhao Wang from Qianxin Company, Honghu from Pennsylvania State University, and Pui Su from Chinese Academy of Sciences. This is the agenda for today. We will start by understanding what is binding code and what's their features. Then in the next part, I will go through a motivating case. It's a zip overflow vulnerability in Adobe Acrobat. Through this case, I wanted to demonstrate that cooperative mutation is essential in finding bugs in binding code. After that, in the third part, we will discuss the challenges of achieving cooperative mutation. In the first part, I will present the whole design of our solution called cooperative. It contains three components: native objects clustering, statistical relationship inference, relationship guided mutation. In the fifth part, I will present the bug finding and the evaluation of our solution. And in this part, I will also present some case studies, which are some critical vulnerabilities in their own programs. Finally, the last part is a conclusion. As we all know, scripting languages is very useful and powerful. It's easy to learn and develop. Nowadays, scripting languages are integrated into document processing programs. For example, JavaScript is integrated into PDF and HTML. VB Code is integrated into Office document. In these programs, embedded scripts code are usually used to manipulate the content elements of a document. For example, in PDF, we can use JavaScript to change the color of text, change the size of images, change the zoom of the, and change the zoom of the document, and so on. Vulnerabilities in these embedded scripting languages are very dangerous. Attackers can exploit vulnerabilities in these programs to execute arbitrary code and take control of the system. And every year, many vulnerabilities are discovered in embedded scripting system. So it's essential for us to design an effective method to find bugs in embedded scripts code. First of all, let's look into the internals of document processing programs. The input contains two parts. Native objects represent figures, text, and even annotations. Script code contains scripting languages, like JavaScript code here. The program also has two components to process inputs. They have native code to handle native objects and use language interpreter to execute script code. Actually, the application and the language interpreter are usually developed independently, so there is a gap between two components. What's more, the application is often developed in low-level languages, such as C and C++. So there is also a gap between a high-level scripting language and a low-level application code. To connect two different components, these programs usually have a binding layer to transfer data and transform representation. However, the binding layer is too complicated to be 100% correct, and the bugs are inevitable. Previous work, like five cardo, only focuses on mutating the script code, which may miss complicated bugs. Then in the next part, I'm going to present a motivating case. Through this case, I wanted to explain why previous traditional solution cannot effectively find bugs in binding code. We take a vulnerability discovered by Cooper to demonstrate our concept. It's CVE-2021-286-38. It's a heap overflow in Adobe Acrobat. Successfully exploit this vulnerability can achieve remote code execution. It's so severe that we were awarded with $2,500 bounty for this particular vulnerability, and it had been patched by Adobe. Then let's see how to trigger this vulnerability. First of all, in native objects, we must insert one extra element into function with array. Then in script code, we must utilize JavaScript code to change the zoom type of the document to RefW. What's more, we did an investigation on a large number of white PDF samples, about 20,000 PDF, and found that their fancy width resonance is less than or equal to 256. That means we must insert one extra element manually. There is no original sample that can trigger this vulnerability. So as you can see, to trigger this vulnerability, we must mutate both native objects and script code. And the traditional one-dimensional mutation infer cannot find this sort of vulnerability. Inspired by this vulnerability, we wanted to design a new solution to discover this sort of vulnerabilities related to both native objects and script code. Our solution is cooperative mutation. It is very easy to understand. We mutate both native objects and script code in cooperative manner. So we come to the problem, how to achieve cooperative mutation? First of all, we need to infer the relationship between native objects and the script code. And then we use the inferred relationship to get a mutation in both sides. Specifically, if a script API has a partition connection with some objects in a document, we will assign these objects a high priority for mutation. Otherwise, we just randomly choose some objects for mutation. Then in the next part, we will show the challenges of achieving cooperative mutation. While our method is novel, there are several challenges to be solved. The first challenge is how to infer the relationship between native objects and the script code. Once we have the relationship, we need to solve the second challenge, how to use the inferred relationship to get a mutation. However, when we solve these two challenges, we encounter a new problem. There are so many native objects. That means we will have a huge search space for inferring relationship and getting mutation. It's not doable. To solve this problem, we need to reduce the search space. So how to reduce the search space? We plan to categorize all native objects into different classes according to their semantic feature. So let's come to our challenge zero. How to class the we will have a huge search space for inferring relationship and getting mutation. It's not doable. To solve this problem, we need to reduce the search space. So how to reduce the search space? We plan to categorize all native objects into different classes according to their semantic feature. So let's come to our challenge zero. How to class the native objects into semantic similar classes? Then in the next part, I will present the whole design of our solution and go through each component in detail. This figure presents the overview of our solution. It has three components. The first component is object clustering. It clusters a large number of native objects into a small number of object classes according to their semantic feature. Once we have the object classes, we need to infer the relationship between object classes and the scripting API. This is the purpose of our second component, relationship inference. This component utilizes a statistical method to infer the relationship between native objects and script code. Finally, we come to the third component, relationship guided mutation. In this component, we use the inferred relationship to get a mutation. Then I will show what components in detail. The first part of our solution is object clustering. An object usually consists of some attributes. Each attribute is a pair of name and object. Through our observation, the name of object usually carries some semantic information. So in the first step, we class the native objects with their names. It's very easy to understand. We just put objects with different ID names in different categories. However, in some color cases, clustering objects by their name may not be correct. For example, there are some universal names such as kids, parents. To get a fine-grained object classes, we split and merge object classes with attribute similarity. Specifically, we use this formula to calculate the similarity between object classes. If the similarity is less than a threshold value, we split a big class into several small ones. If the similarity is greater than a threshold value, we merge these object classes into a bigger one. Through these two steps, we finally get a set of fine-grained object classes. The second part of our solution is relationship inference. We take two steps to infer the relationship. In the first step, we do execution logging for all samples and divide them into two sets, success set and failure set. Specifically, we prepare testing code and insert the testing code into the original sample. Then we use the application to open a new sample. If the testing code successfully finds the related elements, we put the original sample into success set. Otherwise, if the testing code cannot find the related elements or produce error, we put the original sample into failure set. So through this first step, we have divided all samples into success set and failure set. After we divided all samples into success set and failure set, we use the statistical method to infer the relationship between object classes and scripting API, and we get a relation map. As you can see from the map, the success rate is the percentage of samples that contain this class of objects in the success set. The failure rate is the same percentage in failure set. And the differ is the difference between success rate and failure rate. We think the differ value represents the strength of the relationship between object class and scripting API. In the second part of our solution, we have got a relation map between object classes and scripting API. In this part, we will use the relation map to get a mutation. First of all, we determine a target API group. Then we take a traditional method to generate a script code. For native objects, we get a seed sample and select objects in this sample for mutation. Specifically, we refer to the relation map. Then in the next part, I will present the whole design of our solution and go through each component in detail. This figure presents the overview of our solution. It has three components. The first component is object clustering. It clusters a large number of native objects into a small number of object classes according to their semantic feature. Once we have the object classes, we need to infer the relationship between object classes and the scripting API. This is the purpose of our second component, relationship inference. This component utilizes a statistical method to infer the relationship between native objects and script code. Finally, we come to the third component, relationship guided mutation. In this component, we use the infer relationship to get a mutation. Then I will show what components in detail. The first part of our solution is object clustering. An object usually consists of some attributes. Each attribute is a pair of name and object. Through our operation, the name of object usually carries some semantic information. So in the first step, we cluster native objects with their names. It's very easy to understand. We just put objects with different ID names in different categories. However, in some color cases, clustering objects by their name may not be correct. For example, there are some universal names such as kids, parents, to get a fine-grained object classes. We split and merge object classes with attribute similarity. Specifically, we use this formula to calculate the similarity between object classes. If the similarity is less than a threshold value, we split a big class into several small ones. If the similarity is greater than a threshold value, we merge these object classes into a bigger one. Through these two steps, we finally get a set of fine-grained object classes. The second part of our solution is relationship inference. We take two steps to infer the relationship. In the first step, we do execution logging for all samples and divide them into two sets, success set and failure set. Specifically, we prepare testing code and insert the testing code into the original sample. Then we use the application to open a new sample. If the testing code successfully finds the related elements, we put the original sample into success set. Otherwise, if the testing code cannot find the related elements or produce error, we put the original sample into failure set. So through this first step, we have divided all samples into success set and failure set. After we divided all samples into success set and failure set, we use the statistical method to infer the relationship between object classes and scripting API, and we get a relation map. As you can see from the map, the success rate is the percentage of samples that contain this class of objects in the success set. The failure rate is the same percentage in failure set. And the differ is the difference between success rate and failure rate. We think the differ value represents the strength of the relationship between object class and scripting API. In the second part of our solution, we have got a relation map between object classes and scripting API. In this part, we will use the relation map to get a mutation. First of all, we determine a target API group. Then we take a traditional method to generate a script code. For native objects, we get a seed sample and select objects in this sample for mutation. Specifically, we refer to the relation map and design algorithm to calculate the mutation probability for each object in the seed sample. In general, the mutation probability is positively correlated with the strength of the relationship. Then we select some objects with mutation probability and mutate selected objects in three mutation strategies. Whole object attribute mutation, whole object mutation, and universal mutation. Finally, we synthesize the mutated sample and the script code together and produce a final input. So that's all of our solution. For implementation, we develop the Cooper in 4,300 lines of Python code, and Cooper has utilized some open source library. In particular, it uses PyPDF to Python library to pass for PDF format, uses zip file and XML Python library to pass Word format. For scripts generation, we utilize Domato and improve it with block-level template. Cooper currently supports two formats, PDF and Word. It's notable that Cooper is extensible and portable. We can easily add some new features to Cooper and also can apply Cooper to other document formats with limited media efforts. Then in the next part, I will show some bug findings and evaluation results of our solution. We evaluate our solution in four aspects. First of all, we investigate the accuracy of our object clustering and the relationship inferring algorithms. Then we apply Cooper to their world program to find bugs. And we also compare the capabilities of bug finding and IG finding in different configurations and tools. To evaluate the currency of our clustering algorithm, we choose the object class generated by Cooper and compare it to PDF format specification. We find this object class is very similar to the page object in format specification. For example, all objects in this class have a type attribute, and all their values are page. As we can see in the right, type is a required attribute, and its value must be page. There are also many other similarities. So we can believe that this object class is just a page object in PDF. It shows the currency of our clustering algorithm. Is the inferred relationship reasonable? We manually compile part of our relation map with the format specification. As you can see in the slides, the left is part of the relation map generated by Cooper. The right part is some related information from format specification. In detail, the AP attribute is the appearance of a notation. The FM attribute is the form X object that constructs the appearance object. The last attribute can introduce an array of a notation. that shows that our relation inference algorithm is reasonable. To fully understand the capability of Cooper, we prepared 5 configurations and compared them in bug finding and edge finding. Cooper 4 is the full feature of configuration, utilizing the inferred relationship to do cooperative mutation. Cooper random doesn't use any relationship, just randomly choose some objects and scripting APIs for mutation. Cooper object only mutates native objects without any mutation for script code. On the contrary, Cooper script only mutates script code without any mutation for native objects. The last experiment is conducted with Tomato. Since Tomato is originally designed to test general JavaScript code, we add a JavaScript template of PDF and a VBA template of Word document. We applied different configurations on Adobe Acrobat, and recorded the bug finding history in 1 week. As you can see from this figure, Cooper 4 found 18 bugs in 1 week, which is the most among all configurations. This result can prove our concept that cooperative mutation is essential in finding edge in binding code. We also do the experiments on Focus Reader. The result is similar to Adobe Acrobat. Cooper 4 was found the most bug. To test the edge finding ability, we apply all configurations to Adobe Acrobat and record their edge finding history in 1 week. We record both script coverage and native coverage. As we can see from the 2 figures, Cooper 4 can find the most in both types of coverage. We also do the edge finding experiments on Focus Reader and Microsoft Word. Their results is similar to Adobe Acrobat. Cooper 4 always finds the most coverage. Their results can also be a proof of our concept. For bug findings, we apply Cooper to 3 real-world programs, Adobe Acrobat, Focus Reader, and Microsoft Word. In 4 months, we totally found 134 previous unknown bugs, got 33 CV numbers, and 59 bugs have been fixed. We were totally awarded with $44.1 bounty. All these vulnerabilities are related to 90 APIs in 11 objects. We did a detailed analysis of these vulnerabilities and simplified them to find out which APIs trigger them. And finally, we got this table. This table may be helpful for us to do bug finding in the future. For example, from this table, we can know which APIs are more likely to introduce vulnerabilities. As you can see from this table, allotations destroyed API has triggered 15 vulnerabilities. And in the future, we can put more attention on this API function. Then I will show you 3 real-world vulnerabilities found by Cooper. The first one is use after free vulnerability in Adobe Acrobat. It's CVE-2021-21028. We got $3,000 bounty for this particular vulnerability, and it had been patched by Adobe. Then let's see how to trigger this vulnerability. First of all, in native objects, we must put 2 different annotations linked by pop-up key on a same page. Then we set the names of these 2 annotations to be empty string. Secondly, in script code, we must use JavaScript code to change the properties of the first code, of the first annotation, and change the page of this annotation. So as you can see, to trigger this vulnerability, we must mutate both native objects and the script code. The second case study is also a user after free vulnerability in Adobe Acrobat Reader. It's CVE-2021-21035. To trigger this vulnerability, we must assign an abnormal value to the action attribute. Then we must use JavaScript code to change the properties of this annotation repeatedly. Finally, this vulnerability will turn out. To trigger this vulnerability, we also need to mutate both script code and native objects. The third case study is a heap and flow vulnerability in Adobe Acrobat. To trigger this vulnerability, we must assign first char attribute a negative integer and adjust the length of friends with array. Then in script code, we just need to use JavaScript code to change the zoom type of the document. Different to other, the former two case, this heap underflow vulnerability is very awesome and powerful because the underflow length and the underflow content are both controllable. The video first charge just control the underflow length, and the fans vice versa control the underflow content. So this vulnerability is highly exploitable. To be honest, this is the most valuable vulnerability I have ever found. To have a better understanding of this vulnerability, I will show you a demo. In this demo, I prepared two POCs of this vulnerability, POC 1 and POC 2. The contents of these two POCs are the same, except for the first char and the waste as well. In POC 1, the value of first char is minus 16, and the first element of waste as well is integer with 442. When we run this POC 1 at crash point, it will underflow 16 integers, and we will see that the first underflow integer is just 442. In POC 2, the value of first char is minus 31, and the first element of waste array is an integer with 441. When we run this POC 2 at crash point, it will underflow 31 integers, and we will see that the first underflow integer is just 441. To make the effect of heap underflow more obvious, we enable the application's backwards full page heap flag. That means the base address of each heap block is aligned with the memory page, and there is an inaccessible page before the heap block. So once the heap underflow occurs, the program will crash immediately. Then let's see the demo. First of all, we use WinDebug to launch Adobe Acrobat Reader and open POC 1. After a while, it will crash. At the crash point, we can see that it underflows 16 integers, and the first underflow integer is just the first element of waste as well. Then we open the second POC in the same way. It will underflow 31 integers, and the first underflow integer is also the first element of fence waste array. So we can draw a conclusion that the value of first char can control the underflow length, and the elements of waste array can control the underflow content. So in my opinion, this heap underflow vulnerability is very awesome and highly exploitable. There are three takeaways for this talk. Firstly, we should consider the relationship between scripting languages and native objects when testing binding code. Secondly, the statistical analysis can help infer relationships. Thirdly, our Cooper is now available at this GitHub repo. I think this idea is general. We infer the relationship between two sets and do cooperative mutation in both sets. In this way, we can effectively find complicated vulnerabilities related to both sides. What's more, we can apply this idea to other systems. For example, HTML and JavaScript, secure language, and database software. Finally, we come to the last part, the conclusion of our research work. In conclusion, we propose cooperative mutation. We propose cooperative mutation to test the binding code of scripting languages. Our system found 134 bugs in Adobe Acrobat, Fox Reader and Microsoft Word, and received 33 CV numbers and $44.1 thousand bounty. If you have any questions about our methods or interested in methods in general, you can contact me via this email. Thanks for attending my talk. I'm ready for questions. Oh, thank you again for your attending.